morning.
Good morning.
Grace and peace to you from our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to this congregation and our service of worship. As we begin today, I have just a couple of announcements that I'd like to share. First is for those of you who are in the room, as we are getting more folks in the room, just a reminder that in an effort to discourage the deep breathing, we're not standing during the singing part. I realize that that might make the service seem kind of long if you can't move. So let me just invite you, if you need to stand at any time, just stand. And I don't think you need my permission to move, but if you felt as though you did, let me invite you to move whenever you feel the need to move. As we think about what it would mean for us to re-engage in public worship and gathered public worship, I will invite everybody to 2 weeks from today, the day of Pentecost, on May 23rd. We are going to get caught up with a number of the aspects of our gathered life that we've had to put on hold. We will ordain and install our officers that were elected last December. And then following worship, we'll have our congregational meeting. With the new CDC guidelines and some enhanced protocol, we think that it's safe for a larger number of people to be gathered. If you feel comfortable coming out, we would really strongly encourage you to come and be a part of the gathered people of God on Sunday the 23rd. Those of you who are at home, please rest assured that we're not going to stop our live stream as we move towards a continued enhancement of engagement for in-person worship. We're going to continue to provide the live stream for those of you who are at home here or around the world. Please know that you are very much a part of our family. A couple of meetings. Tonight there is no youth group because we want you to be nice to your moms. Honor your moms tonight. Do something special. Celebrate that. We'll be together as youth group next Sunday night. The deacons will meet tomorrow night. It will be by Zoom. And if you need the link, talk to Joan. That should have gone out in an email, but talk to Joan or to me and we'll get you the link. That's what I have in terms of announcements. Is there anything else that I've forgotten? Then I will invite those in the room, and if you're at home, do it too. Please stand as Danielle calls us to worship.
Please join me for the call of worship. The Spirit is coming to bless us all with a new song.
Let our joy be complete.
Gifts for the good of all poured out on all to teach us a new song.
Love one another.
Strangers and neighbors, foreigners and family will join in the new song.
No longer servants, but friends.
Come, let us worship, make a joyful noise, rejoicing in the friendship of God.
Let us worship God.
Yeah.
of confession. O God, you are always doing a new thing. We confess that we sometimes close windows against the fresh air of new ideas, against the noise of other people's worries, against the winds of change. God of every place and time, we confess that we often draw the curtains against people who are different, against world news or community concerns. Forgive us our insulation in our locked homes, our shuttered churches, the security systems on our hearts. Open up our lives and let your spirit flow through. Amen. Jesus said, I came not to judge the world, but to save the world.
He also said, having loved his own children who were in the world, He loved them to the end.
The good news is therefore this. In Jesus Christ, we are loved.
In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Loving God, we come to you in worship and thanksgiving. You are greater than we can understand. Open our eyes that we may see the wonderful truths you have shown to us in Jesus. You are wiser than we can know. Still our minds as we worship you so that we can understand the things you are saying to us. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
This morning's scripture reading is Acts 10, verses 9 through 33. About noon the next day, as they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up on the roof to pray. He became hungry and wanted something to eat. And while it was being prepared, he fell into a trance. He saw the heaven open and something like a large sheet coming down, being lowered to the ground by its four corners. In it were all kinds of four-footed creatures and reptiles and birds of the air. Then he heard a voice saying, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." But Peter said, "By no means, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is profane or unclean." The voice said to him again, a second time, "What God has made clean, you must not call profane." This happened three times, and the thing was suddenly taken up to heaven. Now, while Peter was greatly puzzled about what to make of the vision that he had seen, suddenly the men sent by Cornelius appeared. They were asking for Simon's house and were standing by the gate. They called out to ask whether Simon, who was called Peter, was staying there. While Peter was still thinking about the vision, the Spirit said to him, "Look, three men are searching for you. Now get up, go down, and go with them without hesitation, for I have sent them." So Peter went down to the men and said, "I am the one you are looking for. What is the reason for your coming?" They answered, "Cornelius, a centurion, an upright and God-fearing man, who is well spoken of by the whole Jewish nation, was directed by a holy angel who sent for you to come to his house and hear what you have to say." So Peter invited them in and gave them lodging. The next day, he got up and went with them, and some of the believers from Joppa accompanied him. The following day, they came to Caesarea. Cornelius was expecting them and had called together with his relatives and close friends. On Peter's arrival, Cornelius met them and, falling at his feet, worshiped him. But Peter made him get up, saying, "Stand up, I am only a mortal. And as he talked with him, he went in and found that many had assembled. And he said to them, "You yourselves know that it is unlawful for a Jew to associate with or to visit a Gentile. But God has shown me that I should not call anyone profane or unclean. So when I was sent for, I came without objection. Now may I ask why you sent for me?" Cornelius replied, "Four days ago, at the very hour, at 3 o'clock, I was praying in my house when suddenly a man in dazzling clothes stood before me. He said, 'Cornelius, your prayers have been heard and your alms have been remembered before God. Send therefore to Joppa and ask for Simon, who is called Peter. He is staying in the home of Simon, a tanner, by the sea. Therefore, I sent for you immediately, and you have been kind enough to come. So now, all of us are here in the presence of God to listen to all that that the Lord has commanded to say." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning, friends. I'm happy to see you here today. I'm happy to welcome our children who are at home. I want to start by asking if you know a word. We're going to think about words today. If I use the word prefer, do you know that word, prefer? Do you know what that means? Some of you do. If I said, "Would you prefer to have fried chicken or pizza for lunch today?" Would you guess what prefer means? I'm having a hard time hearing you. That's right. Would you rather? A prefer is another way of saying, which do you like better? And if I said, "Well, I have a preference for fried chicken," preference means that's the thing I like. That's what I'd rather have. So I'm thinking about this because preferences have been important to me in a very important part of my life. Eating jelly beans. I love Jelly Belly jelly beans. And one of the things I like most is this pack that has all these amazing flavors in it. There are three different kinds of strawberry flavor in this bag. But here's the deal. When I have Jelly Belly in a bowl at my house, sometimes my friends or people who say that they love me will come and they will pick only certain ones out of the Jelly Belly container. And then I get stuck with all the ones that are like cinnamon flavor or bubble gum or worse, in my opinion. Henry one time gave me a jelly bean that was booger flavored. Thank you very much. So I was so excited when my niece Sarah gave me this jelly bean dispenser that I have now on my wall in my study. It has a little lever, and I have to say it only works with Jelly Bellies because it's the size that this is. But there's a little thing, and you twist this, and then it falls out into the drawer below. What I like about this is, unless you're super good, you can't just pick out all the good flavors. You turn it, and you get whatever flavor comes out, and you'll like it. This is my Jelly Belly container, and I'm going to leave it in the back after church if anybody wants to try it. Do not open the top and dig through. That's a no-no. Let it fall. Accept what you get. Now, why am I talking about this? Because in the Bible verse that Danielle read for us, that talks about a time when people thought that God preferred some people and not other people. That God liked this person, but God wasn't crazy about that person. Now, I can imagine a situation where if Henry came up to you and said, "Would you like a booger-flavored jelly bean?" You might say, "No, thank you. I'd prefer not." Or if I said, "Who wants pizza?" You might say, "Ooh, I love pizza." But I cannot imagine a situation where God is wherever God is, And one person starts to pray, and God says, "Oh, yes, that's Lydia, one of my favorites. I love it when Lydia prays." And then someone else starts praying, and God said, "Oh, geez, that's Pastor Dave again. Will he ever get off my back? I really prefer Lydia." One of the things that the Bible verse that Danielle gave to us today is a great reminder that when anybody prays, God says, "Oh, yes, I've been waiting for this." God loves each of us. God loves all of us. God does not have preferences when it comes to us. God would rather have all of us. So remember that when you're praying and when you're eating jelly beans and all the times in between. Let's pray now. Thank you, God, that you invite us to come together. Thank you for loving us, and thank you for being excited when we come to you. We ask that you'd hear our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
The second scripture reading will be from 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 7 through 11. Now, if the ministry of death, chiseled in letters on stone tablets, came in glory so that the people of Israel could not gaze on Moses' face, because of the glory of his face, a glory now set aside, how much more will the ministry of the Spirit come in glory? For if there was glory in the ministry of condemnation, much more does the ministry of justification abound in glory. Indeed, what once had glory has lost its glory because of the greater glory. For if what was set aside came through glory, much more has the permanent come in glory. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. So, as I mentioned, I like words. I love words. I use words every day. I like long, beautiful words like somnambulist. That's somebody who walks in their sleep. I like short, descriptive words like nifty. And I like learning new words. But the thing is that sometimes when I hear you talking and I'm not entirely sure what you said, I just fit it into some words that I already know. There was a time when we had a youth group trip to Camp Crestfield, and most of the kids were having a great time. I mean, but there was one student who was just miserable. I mean, all day, every day, she bellyached and she moaned about the camp rules and the work we were doing and the unfairness of life in general. And then on Wednesday, it was like a light went on. She was cheerful. She was cooperative. She was lighthearted. Now, I could not leave well enough alone. And I had to poke the bear and ask her about it. And she said, well, I was sure that this place was really lame. But then at breakfast, that lady said that we'd be riding motorcycles after dinner. That's awesome. Well, I thought back and I could not remember any announcement about motorcycles. And this student said, but you were there. She said it. That since it was Wednesday, we'd be having Vespas after dinner. I don't want to miss that. Oh, friend, I said. Not Vespas, Vespers. And I explained that Vespers is a word for a short worship service, often held in the evening. And she exploded. Oh, you gotta be kidding me. The special bonus in this place is more church? Oh, I hate this place. Words and listening, they matter. How many times do we think that we've been listening, and maybe even that we've been hearing, only to discover that we've missed the mark entirely? Acts 10 contains a very lengthy narrative of which you've heard a portion, describing the day that God tried to teach the Apostle Peter some new words and some new ideas. And it was evidently too much, too big, too new for the old fisherman to comprehend. Peter sees the vision containing all of this forbidden fruit. And before the Lord can say too much, he plugs his ears and he shouts, no, no, I'll never do that. I won't betray you again. I won't let you down, God. And that happens three times. The Lord starts to speak and Peter says, no, I can't. He hears the words, but he can't listen. After that, Peter reflects on the experience, and we're told that he was greatly puzzled, that he was still thinking about this vision when the out-of-towners show up. And these guys, they are not merely insiders from another part of the country. They are Gentiles. They're representatives of a Roman centurion who happens to be commanding a significant portion of the occupying forces present in Israel. And while Peter couldn't quite bring himself to pay attention to or to understand what God was doing in the moment, he finds that he's able to listen to these visitors and then, even more surprisingly, to follow them to the home of the centurion and to break with his own custom by entering that home and perhaps even more surprisingly, by pausing to listen. I've been reading this week about a phenomenon that psychologists call closeness communication bias. There are several fascinating studies that demonstrate that, as a rule, the more we feel closely connected to someone, the less likely we are to actually listen to them over time. Once you know someone well enough to feel close to them, then you begin to think that maybe you know what they're going to say, and so you don't listen as attentively. I'll say parenthetically that perhaps Mother's Day is a very good day for you to reflect on whether you have suffered from closeness communication bias in some of your relationships. You see, Peter, he felt very close to God, and he had a very hard time actually hearing what the Lord was trying to say. But on the other hand, a message from the Roman army, from a centurion, what could that possibly be about? I better listen up. Lucy Shaw is one of my all-time favorite poets, and she has a brief verse that gets to this truth. It's called Explorer, and it goes like this. You think you know my map. You've pioneered my wild prairies, charted all my rivers and other bodies of water, traveled my highways and hidden paths. Yet now, when I decide to dam an old creek or cultivate an acre or grow a small forest, do you feel maybe lost a little? I'm suggesting that maybe Peter, like the rest of us from time to time, thought that he had God all figured out. And Peter could not quite wrap his head around the notion that God wasn't everything that Peter thought that God was. As it turns out, Cornelius has had an eventful day as well. He, too, has had visions and questions, and he is far less sure of himself now than he was at the beginning of the week. By the end of our reading, Peter, Cornelius, and everybody else has been shaken free of some of their prevailing assumptions, and everybody is standing ready to listen to a new word from the Lord. Perhaps we, who like Peter, have sought to be faithful and obedient and honest and true for a long time, perhaps we wonder, is it even possible for there to be such a thing as a new word from the Lord? I mean, for so long we have held true to what we've been taught, that God is immutable, unchangeable, that God is the unmoved mover, the ground of all being. How can God change God's mind? Is it possible for God to do something new? Well, Peter's contemporary and sometimes friend, the Apostle Paul, seemed to think so. In the reading that we've had from 2 Corinthians, Paul remembers the fact that for generations we carried around with us God's word carved in stone, that we were loath to hear them or to experience them in any way that would be different from that which our parents, grandparents, great-grandparents had done. And then Jesus showed up, and he lived and spoke the word in ways that blew some of our old understandings right out of the water. The word enfleshed sure sounded different than those words that were chiseled on a stone. And perhaps as Paul wondered how that could be possible, he cast his eyes on the old scroll that contained Isaiah 43, which read, "Do not remember the former things or consider the things of old. I'm about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it?" We as a church have committed to spending some time as a congregation thinking about what it means for us to be witness to and perhaps even agents of reconciliation in a world that is too often characterized by conflict, change, divisiveness, and pain. And perhaps now more than ever, we need to join these our predecessors in the faith and grow in our ability to be good listeners. In particular, it seems to me that if we are going to be able to point toward the peace, the wholeness, and indeed the reconciliation that is offered in Christ, then we must begin, as was mentioned last week, with confession and humility. And the logical next step would be to join Peter and Cornelius and Paul and invest some time and energy in training ourselves to be good and competent listeners. How tragic would it be if we were to miss out on something big that God was doing merely because we think that we've got God and everything else figured out just fine. Thank you very much. I don't need any more information. Dr. Wade Davis is a Canadian professor of anthropology who has the coolest job title I have ever heard. He is officially the Explorer in Residence for the National Geographic Society. Isn't that awesome? He has traveled the world seeking to learn from indigenous cultures, particularly their use of plants for medicinal and spiritual purposes. He's written a sentence that we would do well to memorize. The world in which you were born is merely one reality. Other cultures are not failed attempts at being you. They are unique manifestations of the human spirit. A significant part of learning what it means to be a child of God is realizing that not all of God's children have the same view of the world or of God. Years ago, our congregation was blessed by the arrival of a new family, a young family. They were new in town. Their kids went to the school that was up the street. And they thought that maybe this would be an appropriate time for them to invest in a church and talk about baptism and Sunday school and membership and Jesus-y stuff. Oh, that was music to my ears. And so I dove in headfirst to this relationship. We talked about how Jesus is present in Scripture, and our conversations afforded me a platform in which I could talk about how I try to follow Jesus in my everyday life. And that, in turn, led me to offer what I perceived to be some incredibly wise and very helpful advice when this couple started making life choices that were different than mine. They were raising their children differently than I was raising mine. They were spending their money on what I perceived to be foolish things. They were clearly wrong on some social and political issues. And when I challenged these decisions in a way that, upon reflection, I think was probably less than helpful, one of them said, "You don't get it, do you, Dave? It's not like we're trying to figure out what we want. We know what we want, and that's where we're heading. Can't you see? I don't want to be you, Dave. And if that means that we can't be friends, then I'm sorry." Well, the truth hurts. Not everybody wants to be me. Not everybody wants to be you. And that's okay. David Kiersey and Marilyn Bates were for many years associated with the Myers-Briggs type indicator, a personality assessment tool that helps foster self-understanding. And they've written, "If I do not want what you want, please try not to tell me that my want is wrong. Or if I believe other than you, at least pause before you correct my view. Or if my emotion is less than yours or more, given the same circumstances, please try to not ask me to feel more strongly or weakly. Or yet, if I act or fail to act in the manner of your design for action, let me be. I do not, for the moment at least, ask you to understand me. That will come only when you are willing to give up changing me into a copy of you." Last week, we sat with Jesus in the dirt as he waited for the religious leaders to realize that they, like the woman whom they sought to shame and isolate, had failed to live into God's best for them. Today, we watch Peter and Cornelius look at each other with new eyes and listen to each other, perhaps for the first time, a listening that helps them both to hear the Lord that they claim to worship a whole lot more clearly. I'd like to close with a story of a man of whom you may never have heard, but from whom we can learn a great deal. Isidore was born in a poor family in rural Spain, approximately 1070 AD. He spent essentially his whole life as a hired hand on a farm in the city of Seville, Spain. He and his wife were known as models of piety and generosity. There was a time when he was disciplined for being late to his work in the fields because he had been spending so long in the prayer chapel. And the next time he was late because of his prayers, he arrived at the farm only to discover that there was an angel plowing the fields for him. Isidore and his wife kept a pot of soup simmering at all times so that he would be able to bring home guests at any hour and offer them hospitality. In March of 1622, that's nearly 500 years after his death, the church in Rome surprised the world by declaring that Isidore the farmer was a saint. He was not of noble birth. He lived in poverty, was most likely an illiterate peasant. But for 500 years, people remembered that Isidore listened to them and that he was kind. Nobody knows, nobody remembers whether Isidore preached any sermons or any proclamations that he may or may not have made. But they remembered that he identified with them, that he loved them, that he fed them, and that he heard them. We all have so much to learn. May we approach every one of our interactions, and particularly our disagreements, with the desire to be present and to pay attention. May we listen like Isidore to the end that one day we might look like Jesus. Thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you. Beloved, we have the privilege and the responsibility to share in the joys and the concerns that have been brought forth to us this week, and we have a lot to hold in our prayers as we gather. I would like to extend my greetings on Mother's Day, and as I do so, I want to be particularly mindful of the fact that for many of us, Mother's Day is an amazing time, and we feel celebrated, and we look back with thanksgiving, and we look around with joy, and we look forward with hope. But I would also remind us that as the people of God, there are many of us who experience Mother's Day in a different way, and there are many for whom this is a difficult day. And so I would invite you to truly heed the words of Scripture, to rejoice with those who are joyful, but to find space to be sorrowful for those who hurt. We have some other news that has come in. I would invite you to be in prayer. We have been in prayer with the Moskowitz family for some weeks now. We heard this morning that Ed lost his battle with cancer and passed away this morning. I'd invite you to be in prayer for a family with whom we are connected by virtue of our worshiping attendance. Three young boys, grades 5, 7, and 8, have lost their dad to a heart attack. And he was the custodial parent. Their mother is not in the picture. And so we want to pray for that family and for the community that needs to rise up around them. Elaine Paris Stanton invites us to be attentive to several folks who are in need of prayers. Denny Cyphers has a cousin whose husband Mark Hatfield is a pastor and a coal miner in West Virginia, and he suffered horrific injuries in a mining accident last week. And Mark's husband Bob was admitted to the same hospital. Mark's father Bob was admitted to the same hospital for stroke and pneumonia and COVID this week. We pray for Elaine's granddaughter, Cassie, who is 6 months old, anticipating an MRI and brain scan, looking for testing for some regular medical irregularities. And prayers for Adrian Paris Reynolds. Some of you may remember her parents, Bob and Pat Paris. She's dealing with cancer in her mid-50s. John McConnell has been transferred to Manor Care, where he is making good progress. I invite you to be in prayer for Ginny Jones. Ginny had been hospitalized. She was released. Now she is back in the hospital and awaiting some tests on that. Invite you to be, I've made aware this morning of a situation, prayers for a friend. Her marriage is in such a way that she has had to call out a PFA on her husband. And so we pray for that family. We pray for Joanne, who is a regular online worshiper with us, not known to many who gather personally, but online. And she is experiencing difficulty with pain and breathing. We have a number of friends who are dealing with COVID, including Becky Mell. And I understand now that Becky's mom, Barb Wozner, is also ill right now. Prayers for two colleagues of my wife. One lost a son to suicide a couple of months ago, and so is experiencing great disorientation on this Mother's Day. And one who is experiencing a severe and significant depression. Those are the things of which I was made aware this morning. Are there others that you would call to mind with the gathered people of God? Sharon.
Two in the chat, one prayer for Thanksgiving that Janet's sister Debbie has been told that she's in remission. So that is good news. Prayers for people to be helped.
Debbie Beatty, Janet Sabracia's sister, who has received a marrow transplant for her leukemia, has found out that she is now in remission. And we are grateful to God for that.
And Hannah asks prayers for people in Colombia in a time of unrest.
Prayers for people in Colombia in a time of unrest. Anything else this morning? Let us then go to God in prayer. Holy One, we lift up to you these whose names and stories are well known to somebody within the sound of my voice. We praise you for the fact that you have created us to live in community. And we ask that you would sustain us when that community seems to be taxing or wearying on us, when it feels like a heavy load. We ask that you would equip us to be functioning in that role so that we might help others and perhaps prevent them from being crushed by the weight of depression or grief or illness or despair. We pray your presence with those this morning who mourn. We lament the sting of death and the reality that that brings to our lives. We ask that you would sustain those whose grief is well known to us and those whose grief is seen only on television screen or heard only vicariously. We pray for those who struggle against illness. Even as we celebrate steps that have been taken toward health, we know that there are people we love who are in harm's way and who are fighting this morning. We pray that you would sustain and bless and equip. We lift up to you doctors and nurses this Nurses Week. We ask that you would equip them to be your hands and feet, that you would provide them with acuity, with creativity, with compassion and energy. We pray, Lord, that you would make yourself known in the way that the nations are ordering themselves. We lament the inequity that this virus has exposed. We pray for those who are desperate for a vaccine, for those who are desperate for medical supplies, even as we appear to have more than we need of each. We ask that you would make a way for justice to come and equity to prevail. We lift up to you those who are in charge of making political decisions, those of us whose responsibility includes voting in this month to come, those of us whose responsibilities include governing. We pray that we might in any measure be found to be agents of your movement and justice and hope in the world. We give you thanks for the gift of families, and we ask your blessing on those of which we are a part. We pray that you might move each of our families towards a deeper model of wholeness and healing, that it might become a safe place for us and a safe sanctuary for us to offer others. And we pray with those whose experience of family is not what they wished that it was, what they hoped it would be, or what they deserved even. We ask that you would be gentle and tender with those who experience pain today. Walk with us, we pray, into this week. Help us to be alert and attentive to the thing that you're doing. Help us not to be bound by our impressions of what you had been doing, with our expectation of what we think you ought to be doing. Help us to be open to where you are moving, and then impel us to get there. In the name of Jesus the Christ, who invites us to pray together using the words that he himself taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The rains of God come in abundance. God provides for our daily needs. How shall we show our gratitude? Giving is not a dutiful obligation so much as a delightful opportunity. What a joy to give thanks. What a blessing to be able to share. Those who are worshiping in the building this morning will note that there are offering plates at the rear of the sanctuary. You may feel free to leave your gift there now or on your way out of the room in a few moments. Those who are worshiping online will find instructions on the screen.
We pray that our unity will be seen not only in what we believe, but also in how we work together to be salt and light in this world. May our gifts today be a sing for each other and the world, that we pledge to work together in your name for the healing of this broken and hurting world. Through Christ our Lord, amen.
Now, beloved, go out into the world in peace and have courage. Hold on to that which is good and return to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted and support the weak. Help those who suffer and honor everybody. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. And let the whole church say, Amen.
for me.